New Hope TV, your encounter with God.
Because God makes his appearance only in chapter 38, we think it's, you know, it's like a long time when Job was without help. Or, you know, Job suffered. But actually, Bible scholars feel it could not have been more than a few weeks. Maximum a few months. I'll give you a few months. I'll give you the quote for that. Job chapter 7 verse 3, it says, I have been allotted months of futility. I have been allotted months of futility. So Job's time of hardship were for a few months at worst. Not beyond that. You know, somebody else, it may be slightly longer or less. But what I'm trying to say is there is a time period. There is an expiry date to your problem. Look at, you know, some people say, look at the apostles. Did they prosper? In Acts chapter 3, Peter and John went to the temple. And what did Peter say on behalf of both of them? First he said, look at us. Then he said, Peter said, silver and gold have I? None. So obviously they don't have money, these two people definitely at that time, you know. And maybe they didn't have anything back home. They did not have money at that time. But yet this is the same John who's praying that I pray that you will prosper. Then they say, look at Jesus. Jesus said, I do not have, foxes have holes and, you know, birds have a nest to lay. I don't have a place. Look at Jesus. But don't you know what scripture says? 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 9 says, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, for your sakes he became poor. Jesus was rich. His name is the Everlasting Father. The Everlasting Father is a rich father. He laid down that riches so that he... and became poor so that he can give it to you. We are heirs and co-heirs with Christ. What is our elder brothers is also co-heirs. You might say that's only spiritual riches. But wherever the gospel has gone, people have prospered. Their lifestyles have changed, you know. The families have looked up. You go through the entire world. I cannot find where the gospel is followed by long periods of poverty. Or people have become poor because of the gospel. I'm not saying that gospel is money. I'm not saying, please don't get me wrong. But I'm just saying when the Lord moves into a place, God's lifestyle will move in. I'm not suggesting that you and I should chase after prosperity or riches. That's why I said in the beginning, hear the whole message. None of the people in the Bible who prospered chased after prosperity or riches. Abraham had a chance to get rich. The king of Sodom said, you take all these goods, give me the souls. Abraham said, I don't want it. My God will make me rich if I have to get rich. But I will not give the credit to you. I will give the credit only to the... He had the chance. Everything was there. He said, you take. But I will not even take the shoelace, right? I will not even take that, which ties your sandals. I will not take that. He had the chance. He refused. When Lot wanted, he said, you take. The fertile, the green, what is pleasing to your eye, you take it. I will take the, if you go there, I'll take the lousy part. Was he looking for riches? Was his heart in the riches or in prosperity? No, he was after God. And that's how we should be. We are children of Abraham. We are not to go after prosperity. We are not to run after riches. We don't have to do that. It's the Lord who prospers. If Isaac wanted to prosper, he too could have gone to Egypt like everybody else. But he obeyed the Lord and he stayed where he was, in the land of famine. And we know he sowed there and he prospered and continued to prosper till he became exceedingly prosperous. Who prospered him? The Lord. If David wanted to become rich, he could have become rich. He could have become the king many years ago. But he could have finished off Saul and become king. And all the riches would have become his. But he waited upon the They were not people after riches. Do you know when God said, you cannot build the temple, He said, okay, fine, I cannot build the temple, but I am going to provide for the temple. Out of my treasury, out of everything that I want, I am going to. I mean, look at the heart. Where is His heart? His heart is where the Lord is, not in His treasury. If you read the prodigal son story, unfortunately, many of us do not realize what the Lord has kept for us. We don't realize that the Lord delights in the prosperity of His children. If we don't realize that there is some blessing in the Bible, you will go without it. If you read the parable of the prodigal son or the story of the prodigal son, when the younger son comes back and the elder brother hears that, he gets upset and he goes away. His biggest complaint was, you did not even give me one goat, a young goat that I may party with my friends. Right? In the father's house, the servants have bread to spare, and the elder son, who is supposed to get double inheritance, he says, you did not even give me a young goat. And then the father, this is very powerful what I'm going to tell you, please receive it. Okay? The father tells him one thing. Son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. All that I have is yours. Why didn't you take it? Why didn't you take it? You are asking for a young goat. All the goats, all the calves, all the animals, they're all yours. Why didn't you take it? You're always with me. You're my son. And like this, we are people who are in the church with the Lord all the time. And the Lord is saying, why didn't you take it? What's the meaning of that verse? All that I have is yours. I mean, take it. Why didn't you take it? Or why didn't you ask me? We are waiting, Ask and you shall. We don't even ask because we don't know what's the heart of the Lord. What a tragedy. He's lived in the house for years as he claims to be as a faithful son, but he's never taken one thing which, he had access to. How many believers have gone through life and never enjoyed what the Lord has? And when they go to heaven, they might complain, Lord, that believer who came yesterday, you blessed him so much. Is this the... And the Lord says, son, you've been my son for years. Why didn't you? All that was yours. Why didn't you take it? You think I want your goats in heaven? God is going to kill our goats to party in heaven? No. It's for us. The cattle on 1,000 hills are mine. For us. He created it all for us to enjoy and to have. In fact, the Lord brought all the animals before Adam and to see what he would name. He gave him naming rights, which means he has the ownership rights. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. From Genesis to Revelation, I see health. I don't know what you see, but I see health, I see healing. In Genesis 20, Abraham prayed for Abimelech and his wife and his servants, and they all started having children again. Amen. Healing. The first book. Go through the Bible. I don't have time to, I wanted to do that, but I know we'll run out of time. I wanted to go through the entire scripture and, pull out healing and health, from Genesis to Revelation. What did Jesus say again in Luke? There were many lepers in the time of Elisha the prophet. Just as there were many widows in the time of Elijah, there were many lepers in the time of Elisha the prophet. Many people were there in Israel who were sick. Oh man, there were so many people who were sick in Israel. And to not one of them not one of them were cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. Elisha has been anointed with power to heal the entire leper population of Israel. There were many lepers. God anointed Elisha with power to heal everyone. But no one is looking to the Lord. No one is claiming healing. No one is claiming health. Finally, the Syrian king hears about it. And he receives the word which, a small girl tells him, Israelite, girl who's been taken captive. He receives the word. Naaman receives the word. And through the king, he drives all the way to Israel for healing. So many of God's children may be carrying infirmities when we are not looking to the Lord. There were many look at the tragedy. Look at the amount of medicine bottles on God's shelf that have never been taken by us. The medicine bottles are all arranged within arm's reach, within arm's length, but we are not taking it. We go to every other dispensary, as Anwanti was sharing with the woman with the issue. We go to every other physician, we go to every other advisor, we go to every other consultant, except we come to the pharmacy of the Lord. In Matthew 15 and also in Mark 7, we know that a woman whose daughter was demonized came to the Lord for setting her daughter free. And what did Jesus answer? What did Jesus tell her? Jesus said, it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. Right? She asked for healing or a deliverance for her daughter. Did she say she was hungry? No. Did she say her daughter is starving? No. Why is Jesus talking about bread? If Jesus was talking about bread when he was faced with feeding the 5,000 plus the women and the children, we can understand. I cannot give the bread for the children to all you people. Assuming there were some unbelievers in that group. Why is Jesus talking about children's bread when a woman is coming to him for healing? What connection, In Tamil Nadu, there's a saying, it's one of those proverbial sayings, Abdul Kadarko Amma Vasiko Enna Sambandham. In the meaning, there's no connection, What does a Muslim have to do with some Hindu ritual? Abdul Kadarko Amma Vasiko Enna Sambandham. In the same way, she is asking for healing and deliverance for her daughter. Jesus is talking about bread. She's got money, she can buy bread. She hasn't lost her money. The other woman lost all her wealth. This woman has got money. She just wants healing. She just wants deliverance. Jesus is talking about bread. Unless the bread of children is healing. Unless the bread of children is healing. The bread of you and me is health, is healing. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Oh, hallelujah. I am the bread of life. You want health and life in your body, in your mortal body? Eat the bread. Eat the bread. You prepare a table for me in the midst of my enemies. On that day, on that table, do you think there is bread? Instead of taking the bread and eating it, we are still looking at the enemies. God has furnished a table for us in the middle of our problems, and He's saying, you take and drink, you take and eat, but we are still looking at the enemies. Oh, that person did this, or this person did this. God is saying, eat. Your soul will be healed. Your spirit will be healed. Your body will be healed. Eat. Anybody happy? Matthew 7, 9. What man is there among you? If your son asks for bread, will give him a stone. Will any of you? If your son asks for bread, will any of you give a stone? And you think when we ask our Heavenly Father for bread, He will give us stones in our kidney? Hello? He will put a tumor in your breast or in somewhere else? The bread is there, the table is there. The bread is there, the table is there. What did Jesus teach us to pray? Give us this day our daily bread. If you and I are standing and sitting here healthy, it's because we have eaten our daily bread. Health. That bread has healing. That bread has nourishment. That bread has strength. That bread is powerful. Why does God want to prosper us and to heal us? Because He will get the glory. Do you know when Solomon never prayed for wealth? Solomon just prayed, Lord, give me wisdom that I will do what you want me to do. His heart was set on God. See, look at any of them. All their hearts were set. Their souls were, they wanted their souls to prosper. And God said, because you've said, because your soul is, all this will, I will give you. He was so wealthy that when the Queen of Sheba came, do you know one word, one line which he said, amazing. She said, blessed be Jehovah your God. Queen of Sheba, unbeliever, she came to Solomon, saw his style, saw his, the way his servants were moving around. And she said, blessed be Jehovah thy God. Because Jehovah loved Israel forever, therefore made He the king to do justice and righteousness. Who got the glory? Jehovah. Jehovah got glory. And I'm sure when she went back on her, you know, chariot, she must have been singing, there is no God like Jehovah. Long before, you know, these are the days of Elijah, there's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. Who got the glory? When God blesses His children, who gets the glory? Because we know and people around us know that these guys could not have done this. This must be God. When you are blessed, I know that it must be God. When I am blessed, you know that it's not, you know, I just can't do anything. But it is God. I just want to take few more minutes and just quickly close the verse. I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. That's a dangerous verse. Ooh. Imagine if our health and our prosperity were just as, you know, as good as our soul's prosperity. Would we still be sitting here or would we be in some hospital? I pray that you may prosper and be in health just as your soul prospers. There are a lot of things I want to say, but I'll quickly say this. If you read that letter further on, he says, I rejoice greatly when brethren came and testified that the truth is in you. The first sign of soul prosperity is that the truth is in you. When you receive Jesus as your Savior, the truth, and He comes to stay inside you, the truth is in you. When Jesus comes into your life, first sign of prosperity. The first sign that you were in misery and now prospering. Second, he says, as you walk in the truth, not only that you receive the truth, but you are walking in the truth. Listen, Anuanti instructed us, right? I mean, through the word of God. If you have a wound, don't keep removing the scab every time. It'll never heal. Right? if I'm hurt and I keep magnifying that, I will never, that wound will never heal. That's instruction. That's truth. Now, if I walk in that, I will be healed. But if I say no, you know, it's just nice to, you know, the truth was there. I received the truth, but I'm not walking in the truth. The last thing he says is, you do faithfully whatever thou doest. Whenever the Lord asks us to do anything, our job is to do it faithfully. Whatever responsibility the Lord has given us, we are expected to do it faithfully. It is required of those who have the word that they be faithful. We are people who have the word, Jeremiah. We are expected to be faithful. You know, all our prosperity and our health is not for ourselves. It's for the kingdom. It's for the kingdom. We are sojourners. We are travelers passing through. If we can impact the kingdom with our wealth, if we can impact the kingdom with our health, we are laying up treasures in heaven. We are people who are called to be kingdom focused. We are a people called to be Jesus focused. We are a people, you know, we're very clear why the Lord is going to bless us. It's okay to enjoy that wealth. Absolutely nothing wrong. You know, God delights in the prosperity. But our joy is not in that. I mean, we will enjoy it, but I'm saying our joy is in seeing the kingdom advance. Our joy is in seeing the Lord's work being done. I pray that all of us will prosper in all things and be in health. And I pray that our soul will also prosper. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the word. We thank you for the word. We thank you for the word. We thank you that you're an amazing God. You never change from Genesis to Revelation. You will never change beyond the end of time, Lord. You are the God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you because you're a God who delights to prosper us. Thank you, Lord, because you have accepted us in the beloved. Thank you for having adopted us as your sons and your daughters. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. If we, being evil, know how to give good gifts to our children, how much more will you? Jesus, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Let this word go like a bullet into our hearts, like a sharp sword into our hearts, O Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Let us know who you are and let us live lives like the children of the King. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.